have an amazing group of amazing people on with us today. Of course, Ms. Jasmine Hernandez, lovely herself. Ms. Kimberly Marshall, lovely number two. Ms. Kathy Marshall, lovely number three. Chris Heaney, I'm give you a headache today. Jamal, our steady Eddie. I've got Ryan Kohler, the one that'll make you think, and Scott Smith, the one that'll make you think even more. You guys, I appreciate everybody taking time to jump on today's webinar. We've got a good set of information today. We'll try and stay on time. I know these have ran over a little bit, but today's been a long webinar day. So with that, let me share my screen and let's rock and roll. First, I'd like to thank everyone who's taken time out of your busy schedule to join us for today's webinar. As a reminder, you have two ways to get this content. Number one, join us live like you are now. Number two is you can go to ciwebgroup.com. Under the education tab, there is a new link. You can grab this. It's on-demand training. Inside this area, this is how easy this is. I know things are getting crazy with summer. You guys are getting busy. However, we can't stop feeding our minds positive and new information that's going to keep us innovative and excited, enthusiastic about growing our business. So this information is available for you to watch at any time. Easiest way to do it, you go here, you choose the topic. So if you want to join us for our establishing your brand voice and identity, the class we did last week, or the breakout session and live focus group, or our customer loyalty or pay-per-click or the entrepreneur mindset, this keeps going. The growth hacker, I know Ryan, that was your baby. Lead conversions, every one of these classes is available. Just click the link. Click here, register, boom, you're in. You don't have to wait until a specific time of the day or day of the week. You guys can rock and roll anytime you like and feel free to share those. We greatly appreciate it. All right, with that, you guys, today the topic is essentially the results plan. If you were on the webinar earlier today, don't worry. We've got new information that's part of this. It's not gonna be the same as earlier. So stick around. Essentially, what we're going to do during this, kind of the same as last week, is we want to use this session to help create inspiration, creativity, ideas, and the motivation to continue to modify what we're doing every day so we can produce another result. I know people get stuck in two places. Number one, stuck and stuck. Number two, stuck and overwhelmed. Kind of the flailing place of excuses that prevents us from creating change and getting new results. Ryan, I know you deal with a lot of customers, entrepreneurs, I should say, in this environment. And I'm going to call it the busy being busy, never going anywhere, the rocking chair syndrome. How important is it to break the fallacy of saying I'm too busy being busy to make change?
Yeah, I think it's supposed to, I think there's a saying that is execution is as much about what you don't do as what you do do. And that really encapsulates it. Like if you're too busy, then we have a prioritization problem, right? And picking like the order that you do things in, and because we're all too busy. Like if we weren't too busy, I'd be worried. Like it means you got nothing to do, right? But that really, I think the difference between companies that are successful and not, or entrepreneurs that are successful or not, it's their ability to do things in the right order and to choose what not to do, what fires to let burn and what fires to put out, right?
Absolutely. So figure out the things that only you can do, dedicate to them, get everything else off your plate as quickly as possible. As an entrepreneur, you have to create space for the amazing goodness that you have to bring to market because it's your job as the leader of the company to do so. So we have to make time. If we find ourselves in a position where we're saying we don't have time, it's actually the exact definition of why you need to make time, because you should be able to create it, right? If you find yourself stuck and in that circle, that is a bad place to be. So pull yourself out of it, make time, and you're going to be able to implement things that are going to create new time so you can focus on things that matter. That being said, we're going to talk for a little bit about target marketing, but before we dive into this, we're going to go through just kind of a quick sprint of what to expect as you go through this process. First and foremost, anytime you're getting started with a new marketing strategy, somebody's got to dive in and they have to analyze where you are. They've got to figure out where is your business currently, and they have to do that with limited information. Any agency, any recruiting firm, any marketing, any branding company, ideally when they're first diving in, they only have access to superficial information, depending on what level of access you'll give them to all the rest of the goods they need to see in order to help you guys put together a plan. This scientific experiment in the beginning, essentially, it means that most companies are guessing out of the gate because not all of the information that's necessary, the history and the data to be able to make really good quantifiable decisions is available. So some of this is depending on your experience in the industry and their ability to be able to make some choices and decisions based on history. And sometimes it's based on other people's history. So the process of evaluating where you are, where you want to go, and who you got to knock out of that space to get there. This is not a project. This doesn't happen once before you get started on your new marketing strategy. This happens continuously at multiple checkpoints at all times. If we love our results and we don't want to grow and we don't want to improve our margins and we don't want to improve our customer satisfaction rating, or we don't want to improve the quality of our employees or their processes and procedures, then we should stop researching. We should stop analyzing. We should stop trying to find fault or challenges, gaps, inefficiencies, duplicate processes, things we need to improve. Ryan, I'm going to go back to you. In your world, sometimes I see a lot of our entrepreneurial clients stick with their current strategy, whether it's for hiring or, I mean, for anything, stick with it because of what they're comfortable with. It's the way they've always done it. It's comfortable. What do you notice on the hiring side?
Oh, man. I mean, that really is it. And you take it a step further, what they're comfortable with, which is based on, you know, problems they've had in the past, fears that they have, bad situations in the past, or what they're comfortable with because everybody else is doing it. Those two things, like your job is to solve bigger and bigger problems, not to consistently do the same thing. And the entire world is changing around us all the time. In every moment, like, it's the same with marketing as it is with product development, as it is with hiring. Like, the world's changing. Just accept that. The world's changing. If you're the only one standing still, you got a problem. But it is like we crave comfort, and instead we need to crave like building capacity. We need to get better at what we're doing instead of hoping it goes away, because it doesn't. Like,
that's fair. Here comes the headache. Chris, technology-wise.
Oh, man. If you stay in your comfort zone for too long in technology, you'll die quickly. Technology changes very, very rapidly. You can pretty much Google for average lifetime of a fill in the blank website, anything, and you can see there are very short lifespans. So being able to be comfortable, the only comfortable you should really be is comfortable with change, and being able to adapt and be agile.
That's real. A lot of times I'll see entrepreneurs or business owners talking to a digital marketing or a technology strategist, and they kind of have a defensive posture of, you're just trying to sell me something. No, actually, that technology that this was built on, it's gone, it's retired, it's no longer valid. In fact, there's a penalty for using it. Like, it's that big of a difference, right?
The terminology is forced upgrade. Definitely Google will force upgrade you. Your phones will force upgrade you. If you don't upgrade what you're doing in Google, you're not going to show up. If you don't upgrade your phones, the apps will stop working. It pretty much just stops working. You gotta keep changing.
That is so sometimes the philosophy is kind of this conspiracy theory of they want to create things that are going to break so that you have to spend money. So I don't want to buy into that conspiracy theory. Is that the right mindset to have when it comes to technology, or should we be thinking about evolution of technology as something we need to adapt because there's a positive reason behind it? They're trying to deal with something like security or new devices or new technology or AI or something else.
For entrepreneurs, I like Bob Parsons' 16 rules. It used to be 14 rules. Rule number one is get out and stay out of your comfort zone. All the other rules are fantastic. I put it in the chat.
Okay. All right. Good deal. So essentially, you guys, you got to be a scientist behind this. Scott, in your world, the science behind video, has it evolved and how has it changed in the way people are adapting it with their business?
Has it evolved? When I first started in this business, we went from to edit video, you had to have a suite full of equipment that cost millions and millions of dollars. And cameras, broadcast cameras were roughly $25,000 to $30,000 a piece. Now I can put it all in a backpack, an edit suite on a laptop, and cameras, and travel the world with both the edit suite and the camera package. So yeah, it's changed a little bit, and it keeps changing. What I found interesting, and now we're becoming more in tune with worse and worse video, I guess, is the quality. And we're accepting of it. I mean, back when I first started broadcast quality, you had all these charts and meters that measured light color and everything else, and nobody really cares anymore. And I'm seeing that with COVID and all these webinars too. It's just continually, as the cell phones give great high def video, but we've even taken it a step lower with all the webcams. I mean, look at me. My camera turns me red 3/4 of the time, and everybody else. So yeah, it's just crazy how it all works and transitions. And you better just hang on. Luckily, in video, it's become more consumer friendly and cost effective because of that. So now people can do anything. You're seeing full movies done on iPhones, and it's just incredible. So yeah, hold on, watch out, but it always, the great thing is it always benefits the consumer, and that's as a business owner, that's a good thing because now you can play in the same field as the big guys and really help market yourself with the power of video.
So you guys, that's 100% on point. When I talk about analyzing your business, I mean to the nth degree. If you used to train new employees in a training room all in your office and you sat down with your paper workbook, you might be looking at or want to reevaluate that. Hey, we can create some onboarding videos, training videos. We can create a tutorial. We can create quizzes within those videos. We can see how long they watched. We can test them after that. And guess what? When we do onboard a new employee, we have the ability to send them to our entire training manual through live interactive videos and actually get some engagement out of them. So that reassessment is put every piece of your business under a microscope and constantly reevaluate, because you can't figure out what you need to do next unless you rip apart what you're already doing. That being said, I'm going to refresh this so that I can get everything in here. And I'm going to close this. All right. So next is essentially creating the plan. You guys, when you sit down with this strategist, you sit down with Clay, you go through what are you doing in your current business, what's happening. Next is you sit down as an entrepreneur and say, this is where I want to go. We get all these bright ideas, we're so excited, and then we get down to allocating the resources to get where we want to be, whether that's human or financial, whether you're doing it yourself and allocating time, or whether you're hiring someone else and getting it off your plate, whether you're subscribing to a new software or system. There's a big gap often between what my bright ideas are as a business owner and how I'm going to implement or execute those ideas, what I'm willing to commit to it, and understanding the difference. Sometimes some of those commitments are going to be you committing to a process. You as the business owner, your team is the team that needs to execute something. For example, learning how to use a new review acquisition system and having your entire team join you for that training. Or it might be buying a new piece of technology like a chatbot, or it might be investing in search engine optimization. Bottom line is, your investments are sometimes in your own time, sometimes they're in technology, sometimes they're in process, and sometimes they're in people or outsourcing. And being able to identify what are those things you need to invest in to be able to get closer where you want to go, that's going to help. Out of the gate, when you start a digital marketing project, one of the questions we get asked all the time is, why is there an initial fee or why is there a monthly fee? The first thing that a web company has to do is set up servers. They've got to set up servers, the infrastructure and everything to hold or contain the website that they're building. So you have a live site sitting on a server, you have a dev site sitting on a server, setting up the infrastructure, putting the security in place, starting to purchase those things like an SSL certificate from a security standpoint, a content delivery network. All of those things just sound like bogus acronyms, but the reality is, in order to build a site and go live with the site, you have to have the infrastructure to build it. It doesn't live in space and never land. So those are some of the things that have to happen first. Chris, I know you get questions a lot, as does Jasmine and Kim and Jamal, on what's the process before or while a website's being built? Does it require the same kind of management and or security as a website that's live on the internet? Chris, I'll go to you first.
Yeah, if you're live on the internet, that means you're exposed, period. So if it's live under the internet, under development, it means web traffic can hit it. It means that security is still a concern, because if it gets infected in that environment, then transferred to a live website, then it's just a more exposed vulnerability. So if it's public and on the internet, foundation is very important, especially security.
What's a CDN?
Content delivery network.
Why is it important?
Because there's lots of reasons, but it saves your bandwidth significantly. It's faster. So content delivery network, one of my favorite content delivery networks is actually Netflix, because people watch movies at night. So the content is the movie. Let's say The Matrix, I don't know any recent movies, but say The Matrix was popular. Could you imagine that digital file, video file is physically moved where the earth turns? So the content delivery network keeps the content closest to the user. That means if you're in Alberta, Canada, and request your HVAC website, that the images being delivered are being delivered from a local server, because your website is literally distributed across the internet, the same way The Matrix is for Netflix. So content delivery networks, very important for bandwidth. And if you could physically see how it moves around, it's absolutely incredible. The infrastructure behind content delivery networks are very impressive.
Good deal. So these are just some of the things that have to get set up out of the gate. Obviously, a server and your CDN, your SSL or security certificate or secure socket layer, which is part of your creating your HTTPS environment, which is a secure environment for your website. These are all just some of the bells and whistles. Other things that need to be in place before you start rocking and rolling on digital marketing, obviously getting your domain set up. You guys, there's 101 places to buy domains. It's simple. Use google.domains.com or domains.google.com. It's a simple place. Everything lives in the same environment. Your email hosting, same thing. Use your G Suite umbrella. Under the Google umbrella, just imagine having everything you need from a technical standpoint under one login and password, instead of having it discombobulated across 50 different locations. If you log into Google, you have your domains, you have your emails, you have your documents, you have your analytics, you have your YouTube account containing all of your videos, you have your Google business listing. Literally everything lives under that single umbrella. What we notice a lot right now is dealers will have just kind of randomness going on with all of the different accounts and third-party services they have in place. They'll have Namecheap as their domain host. They'll have another email hosting company, which they don't know the name of. They'll have a different company that has hosting is hosting their website. Everything is all over the board. They've got a marketing company with some custom reporting tool instead of using Google Data Studio. I mean, literally, the more complex you make it, separating all those things out creates security issues, safety issues, complexity issues, not knowing how to log in. Right now, the number of websites we have sitting in our pipeline, that have been done for months, but we don't have a login and password because they can't figure out where their domain is. Jasmine, how real of a scenario is that?
I have four of them currently right now that are in my pipeline ready to go live, and the client goes non-responsive because they're getting busy. They're out there running calls, and I'm just waiting to get their domain details that they don't have, and I have to go to someone else to find them that doesn't want to give them to me because then they lose their business.
Absolutely. Kim, have you noticed issues with dealers buying domains or getting things set up? Actually, not buying them themselves, but contracting a web company and letting the web company buy them, and all of a sudden they don't own their own website anymore.
Yeah. You already know I've dealt with that a few times, and being new to web projects this year, it's threw me for a loop. But starting to figure it out, having to do a lot of collaboration with the dealer and their previous marketing company. So always own your own domain.
Jamal, what would you recommend as a dealer is going through the process, ownership of their assets? How important is it? What kind of run-ins have you had that prevent them from moving forward because of issues?
So I've had several run-ins. I've had dealers that had to change their domain or to, you know, just purchase a new one and start over. It can be a very touchy situation. So it's always best to own your domain, all of your assets. You want to make sure you're the primary owner of that. Now, it's okay to share access, but not give primary ownership to anyone.
Absolutely. Chris, I see you chomping at the bit. Bring it.
Yeah, so one really big thing when it comes to protecting your domain is protecting your name. And if you go through SBA to get a business loan, or if you've been through any classes, a trademark, a $250 word mark goes a very long way. If anything should happen to that domain, it expires. There's a specific policy by the gods of the internet called ICANN, and they call it their domain dispute resolution policy. The only thing that trumps everything is a trademark, especially if it's industry specific. It's the only way to get your domain back. So with owning your own domain, couple that with a trademark, and you're pretty well protected.
You guys, these things, and I know, Kathy, you've got one hot topic with the expiration dates. You know, you're constantly helping people juggle. What would you give people advice to do as far as their domains go so they don't lose them?
Well, one thing is set your calendar reminder 2 weeks before your expiration date happens. So that way, if the company you're working with doesn't remind you, you're reminded to reach out. Also, set your domain registration to more than just yearly. Do it like 3 to 5 years. So it's like on auto for a while, and you can just kind of let it be. But the biggest thing is own your domain and take the responsibility. That domain registration is all on you. It is your responsibility to renew that. We're going to help you guys to remember to do that if you're a CI Web Group customer, though.
So you guys, these are all things that literally, they sound small in nature. These things can destroy a company. Ryan, I don't know, do you have any friends or businesses that have went through losing something as prominent as your domain and your brand? I don't think people understand how huge of a deal it is to have to start over.
Yeah, it is. And it also is, you know, depending on if you're actively noticing. I did this project, this would have been like a decade ago. The state of Utah invested, man, like $500,000 in this project to generate applicants for jobs in Utah and bring them in here. And we set everything up, and they let the domain expire, and some dude in Florida bought it and put up some like pharmacy site on it, on this domain that was owned by the state. And like, once somebody buys it, then you're just toast. Like, if it's in the renewal period, maybe your website goes down, but if you don't notice it in time, like literally there's no recourse. And so I just add in, like, set it to auto renew. Make sure you set it to auto renew. Your business isn't going to go away next year. And this isn't like, you're not auto-renewing like a $10,000 a year thing. You're auto-renewing like a 12 fucking month thing. Like,
it's 12 bucks. So that's real. Set it to auto-renew. Buy it yourself. It's not easier to have a web company set these things up for you. If they offered, there's a reason they're offering. They're offering typically not to save you time, as pretty as it sounds, or help you with something complicated or technical because you don't want to do it. They're offering because at that point, they have you stuck in a situation you can't get out of. So pause, get help. I mean, literally, you can get on a webinar, you can share screens with anyone on our team. They'll walk you through how to set it up, but also make sure you own it. You need to own these assets. It's wildly important. You guys, losing a domain, it's not, oh, I lost a $12 domain and I have to start over. That is rebranding all of your trucks, buying all new business cards, literally repainting, putting new signs up, you're building, all of your email has to be done, losing years of email history. The amount of
years of SEO history,
losing all your SEO. Oh my gosh. Okay. So on the side,
it might not even be nefarious. It might not even be that they're evil. It could just be like the company went out of business or that they just like, they moved on. It was some 20-year-old kid's little startup business and he just moved on to something else. Like I remember in the early days, I was hosting my site through a reseller and the reseller just didn't pay his bill and went away. My entire site went down.
Right.
Like not just my website, like literally my, all the data of all my clients disappeared off the internet and the person I was in contact with disappeared. Like he literally fell off the face of the planet on a Saturday afternoon.
Welcome to our world.
That is uncommon here.
Yes. We hear these stories all the time. You guys buy your domain from Google Domains. And if it's not there right now, if you have your domain with rogersdomainnames.com, stop, put in a domain transfer request. If you need help, we'll help you get that done. But don't wait to go through the pain to learn a lesson. If you would only do what you already know you should, you'd consider us a genius. So do it early. Don't wait. Right? That's a big deal. So this kind of whole umbrella, this is bigger than that, right? This is operating a business using a Hotmail email address, a Yahoo email address, an AOL email address, .me or @me email address. All of these things are self-destructive. They just are. I don't know a better way to put it. It's self-destructive. It is irresponsible to continue down that path if there is another way and it's not difficult. You can get set up with a domain registered email for a few bucks a month, $6 a month. Start with that. Don't go into business expecting big things, doing small things. All right, that's enough of my preaching on that one. Next, we've got to set up reporting. You guys, there is only one primary set of data that matters, right? It's Google. I mean, you're going to have other key performance indicators and things in your own CRM system and performance metrics you're going to monitor. But what you want to be careful of, a report that comes from a marketing agency with the marketing agency's logo at the top of it, and it's their version of the data. You got to know where the source is coming from. This
My favorite is Excel. I love seeing the Excel reports.
Yeah. If you are getting an Excel report to show your performance, I hope it's an export from Google. You need to see where the export is. Right? Google Analytics has information that can help make decisions. Your reporting, the best reporting system, is not a proprietary reporting system you don't own. So as you're talking to different agencies, something important to ask. If an agency is talking about, I have this amazing reporting system, it's custom, it's proprietary, it's ours, just know that when the happy dating period is gone and you're trying to make a decision, that custom reporting system and those custom reports and all that history, it doesn't go with you. You don't get to take it over so that your next agency can make decisions. So set yourself up, same umbrella, right in your Google account under Google Analytics with you as the administrator, give access, and you can give access to other admins to come in and make changes to your analytics and so forth. But the data that you are using and comparing against, it's got to be raw data that comes from Google. Kim, I know you've helped a lot of dealers get into Google Data Studio. How difficult or how long would it take for you to take someone that has an account, has some history, but isn't able to look at the information in a Google Data Studio environment? How long would it take?
To get a brand new Google Data Studios report set up?
Yeah.
Maybe 10 minutes.
It's not long, you guys. It's not hard. It's not long. How much does Google Analytics cost?
$0.00.
All it is the time it takes to put the report together. So it's time. Depending on the complexities, having a simple report can be put together in 10 minutes. If you want to drill into a complex report that you can make decisions on and so forth, it might be days or hours that go into it. So it just depends on how detailed or granular of information. Chris, what are some of the elements or things you can do inside Google Data Studio from a predictive standpoint?
Oh, wow. That's such an awesome question. And a can of worms. So believe it or not, Google Data Studio can imagine it as a data pipeline, and you don't just get your analytics data. And that's one connector. You can aggregate data from third-party services. You can aggregate data from Service Titan. You can aggregate data from AccuWeather. So as you start to aggregate this data, you start to see what we call in the industry big data trends. So these data trends give you, very similar to the financial space, how you have financial indicators in the stock market that let you know buy, sell. Same thing with search demand. To understand, it's about understanding the supply and demand in your locale and your industry. So Google Data Studio allows you to do that in a predictive measure, depending on what kind of data connectors that you want to add. And there are a lot of different data connectors. And when it comes to the web analytics side, not just Google Analytics, which shows you the perspective of the customer while they're on the site, you can go further up the funnel and get Google Search Console, used to be called Google Webmaster Tools, and Bing has it too. And you know, if you're targeting B2B and corporate, a lot of those corporate offices use Bing and Microsoft as a default. So you know, sometimes you have to target Bing, but if you're targeting consumers, they all use Google. Did that answer the question?
Yes, sir. Thank you. Right. Ryan, do you have any history with Google Data Studio or predictive results?
No, we use Domo, but I'm guessing it's pretty similar, like aggregates all the data together and allows us to do a bunch of stuff. I mean, clearly we have data that comes from our own systems instead of data that's coming from, say, a WordPress or something like that, or Google Analytics. And so, I mean, super important. Once you set it up, it's awesome. But really that is like, can you set up reporting and does it like, and do you know what to do with it? Like, it's not just a report card that you're like, yeah, I get the report, I glance at it, I do nothing with it. But like, actually, like, I look at it for this reason, right?
Absolutely. Make decisions.
It's the difference between insights and actionable insights. Insights are, here's a bunch of data. Actionable insights is, here's a bunch of data and this is what you should do with it. And between the two is a layer of interpretation that sometimes machines are pretty good at if you're out there and you're trying to do the DIY stuff. But as things get more complex, competitors get more complex and different things, sometimes it's good to have an interpretive layer of an agency kind of keying into the results plan to be able to look at that data and interpret what kind of actionable things need to occur to improve that data or those results.
Absolutely. Jasmine, Kim, or Jamal, any one of you, how do you guys use data to drive decisions with clients and changes to their plans on a regular basis?
That's all that we use. I look at the data and see where they're ranking, see if there's keywords I can get to move over to position to page one if they're on position two, but they're getting a ton of traction. We look at what content they'll need to be going into, where we need to focus our targeting efforts at. Even when it comes down to social media, if we see the seasonality, we see what they come up for, we can communicate their social media posting to incorporate that as well as their blog posting, their content posting that's getting published on a monthly basis.
Absolutely. You guys, sometimes without the data, all you're doing is continuing to do new things, add new content, add new pages. When in reality, if you have a page that has a primary service you want to sell sitting on page two, position two, all it takes is five spots for it to all of a sudden start making your phone ring and start making some money. That's the difference between using the data and just getting the data. So we've got to make sure that we're actually analyzing it so that we can make pivot choices and decisions based on what that says. It's not always about adding your new blog post. So in a results plan, the idea behind it is, it's not a lever pulling activity. Most of the time marketing companies, because it's easy for them and for the customers, I know Chris is smiling right now, it's easy for them and for the customers, it is easier to have a lever pulling strategy. That is no brain behind it, right? You sign up for social media and you get 8 posts a month. That's the easy thing to buy. It's the easy thing to do. You sign up for SEO and you focus on one particular thing, or you sign up for blogging and that you get 2 blogs a month, right? No logic, no data, no information to tell you, should I actually be adding a new blog, or should I be taking these 600 words of content and adding it to a page that's sitting on page 2, not making any money, but literally 30 days away from flipping the corner and turning into a cash machine. You got to have enough flexibility to be able to make those decisions and be able to switch, and that reporting is necessary to do so. Next, we talked about brand evaluation. I'm not going to spend too much time on here. I will encourage you, go back to those on-demand videos. We had a full workshop last week, plus we had a live focus group and a breakout session talking about brand. But the reality is, once you get the infrastructure set up, we got to figure out who you are, how you stand out, how you're different. And without having those things in place, it's not easy to be able to create something unique. It's not easy to be able to connect with a unique consumer. So, as a part of your project launch call, when you guys get on the phone and you start sitting down and going through who you are, how you're different, what the differentiating factors are, what market segments are you going after, what is your value proposition or unique selling proposition for them, and literally how are you standing out or differentiating yourself from every other company just like yours, take this seriously. Like, that's all I can say. Take it seriously. Sometimes when you get all the initial onboarding forms, it seems like a task. It's not a task. Okay. This is you. If you're going to spend money on marketing, if you're going to invest in a website, if you're going to invest in content, bring something of yourself to the table. Literally commit to the process. Commit to filling out those questions. Commit to having those conversations internally. Commit to figuring out, you know what? Who are we? What do we stand for? Who are we connecting with? Who is our current customer? Who's our ideal client? And how are we going to modify literally our DNA in order to attract the customer that we want to work with? How do we change who we are? And how do we represent all of that in a digital format so consumers can connect with more than a logo, more than IAQ? Because the next phase, when you move into designing a mobile site, mobile first, that can expand into a website, if you don't participate in sharing the soul of your brand with the people designing it, it's going to look like an HVAC site. It's going to feel like an HVAC site. It's going to be an HVAC site. And without any differentiation, what is the only thing the consumer has to decide on? Anyone want to throw that out?
Cost.
Price. Right. It's price. That's it. Right? If there's nothing else that differentiates you from everyone else, the only thing that a customer is going to look at is how much are you charging? What's your rate? So sometimes business owners, especially in this industry, they'll come to the table and they'll say, all it does, putting a price on a website, all it does is create a price shopper. We create price shoppers by not communicating anything different and leaving them to that being the only deciding factor. We design them, we create them by having nothing unique about what we do that makes them connect to us on a deeper level than product, service, and price.
Listening to the executives of Toys R Us after Toys R Us went out of business, asking what they would have done different. The only answer that was uniform was we would have created an experience for the customer that was different than online shopping, then we would not have been commoditized. And so you aren't just selling cheap cold air. It turns into selling an experience and selling a feeling that you're being taken care of, and assurance. So you're buying assurance, you're buying peace of mind, and you're buying what you know as an expert that you can rely on. So, and there's ways to communicate those differentiators through who you target as your audience. Maybe it's, legal professionals. Maybe it's police officers and military if you're outside of an army base. You know, there's ways to communicate based on who your audience is versus who your brand is.
Yeah, this is, so here's the reality. You guys might not have time to get this done before a website project goes live. That's fine. If you go live with the Taste Like Chicken website because you didn't have time to sit down and have a coming to Jesus meeting with your family and your team to try and figure out literally the essence of your soul and your brand and who you are and who you want to connect with, that's fine. But just know it's still on the list of things to be done. Just know that that's still something that it has to work on. This is not a project. Technically, building a website is not a project. It's a lifestyle. It's an evolution. It's something that has to constantly be top of mind. We have to constantly be reevaluating. Who are we? Who are we trying to connect with? What's important to them? And are we properly connecting with them in a place that creates a feeling that's going to get them to take action? Or are we just publishing content for Google, a robot with no brain? All right, so brand, we're going to come back to that and deep dive into that. Right now, what happens after we start the project? Someone starts coding. After that, so you've got someone that's designing, someone that's coding, someone setting up a server, someone setting up all the security elements of it, and then we get into content. Here's the deal with content. What do I want to sell? Where do I want to sell it? That is your list of products and services that are available on Google or that should be available on Google. There is what content do I have already, and there's what's missing. That's an audit. That's a check that needs to happen. You can't sell something that doesn't exist. So for search engines, everything is literal, right? If you talk to an SEO expert, they're going to talk to you about primary search engine terms, such as AC installation and blank, AC repair and blank, AC service and blank. They're going to talk about keyword density. They're going to talk about making sure that you have X number of words on a page, making sure that you have X number of inbound links, and X number of outbound links. Kim, what is an SEO specialist going to talk about when it comes to these pages?
I mean, what it all boils down to is the authority of the page. Your domain authority is basically the grading of your website overall. All of your pages averaged out equal your domain authority. So basically, it's going to be a balance between adding in new high authority pages and then increasing the authority of existing pages. Doing that regularly, consistently, will drive you up the search engine results page. It's really
okay,
that simple.
Yes, here's where the rubber meets the road. Okay, two different minds. Kim's mind is thinking about a robot, and everything that she just talked about is a number. It's math. It's a mathematical equation. Jasmine, once they're listed on page one of Google, here's this rubber meets the road is, this is the difference. That content that was critical, all those mathematical equations, the keyword density, the number of words, the number of pages, the domain authority, the number of inbound links, outbound links, internal links, blah. Right?
I was waiting for the internal links. You missed it earlier.
Okay, yes. That is the SEO engineer. That's how they think. Because you have to please Google to get in front of human beings. That's phase one. Now, they're on page one of Google. How does this logic with content change when it's a human being compared to a robot? Jasmine.
It has to look nice. You can't just have a bunch of content on a page and it looks outdated and old. You have to have buttons for them to convert with it. The colors have to be aesthetically pleasing to the eye. You can't have harsh colors on top of some dark, dense colors. It has to flow very well because the next step is once you're ranking is how do you look? How easy is it to convert with them? How easy is it to grab your phone number from that website and for them to give you a call? If those things aren't there and they're not easy, you're not going to get the conversions from doing all the SEO and the geeky stuff. You're going to be aesthetically ugly on the eye, which means that your phone's not going to ring even though you're there.
Scott, how does video play a role? So the text on the page is for Google. How are you going to connect?
Well, video is a unique beast. There's been studies done that show that just by reading something, you comprehend a certain amount of information, but video puts it way up there at the top. So it's, you comprehend it much more. It also provides credence and credibility to what you're saying. It's something about it. People not only do they comprehend it, but they believe it. It can take a small HVAC company and make them look like a big HVAC company if done properly. It's just a incredibly powerful tool.
Scott, on that, doesn't the video only have to be about 60 seconds even then, just short clips, something that's interactive and moving on the page just to catch someone's eye?
Well, the great thing about video and YouTube these days is that YouTube is its own search engine. In fact, it's the second largest search engine behind Google. So they allow you to take that video and you not only optimize and SEO your YouTube channel, but you optimize and SEO each video clip. So, right, you can have a 15 or 30 second promotion, and if it's optimized properly, it should get you the same results on Google and YouTube as a 2 hour home movie or whatever it is that you're a 15 minute marketing video, say. So yeah, you're exactly right. Having that video, having it spread on your website and embedded there and using it in social media all the way across numerous platforms gives you the most visibility that you can get. And even if it is a 15-second video promotion, it is highly effective. The great thing is a lot of manufacturers, HVAC manufacturers, have their own marketing sites for their dealers, and you can actually go and pull videos straight from their libraries as well. And we have those as well. So, it's really inexpensive for a dealer to get into and utilize those.
Absolutely. So you guys, when it gets down to kind of your differences, when it comes to building a page, the SEO mind and the brand or conversion mind, these things have to come together at some point. So from a search engine optimization standpoint, if I'm going after IAQ, or indoor air quality, for example, I'm probably going after things like whole house air purifications, humidifiers, dehumidifiers, UV lights, all of these things, products. But if I'm connecting with a consumer who doesn't know what IAQ is, I have to take a totally different approach. I'm not selling UV lights because that doesn't connect with someone who doesn't know why would I ever need a UV light. That doesn't make any sense to me, right? Except to kill viruses. I'll leave that one alone. So IAQ, here's the difference, right? When you create a page, and this is a results plan page, this is totally different than an SEO plan. Pages need to evolve. It needs to get better over time. You launch a website with limited content, then you add a little bit of content for search engines, then you optimize the content to get it to rank, then it starts to rank. Now you need to care about human beings. We have to connect to a human. So here you're going to see something totally different. First, I need to connect to something that makes sense to them. We spend 90% of our time indoors. Is that true for most? Probably. Introduce a philosophy. Hashtag the air you breathe. At this point, see if you can get some interaction. So we have these products, dehumidification, humidification, indoor air filters, blah, 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 ventilation, all of these things, right? We're going to leave those there. See if we can get some interaction. People like quizzes and polls and they like to participate in things. Launch something right out of the gate. This is a lead generator. More than a lead generator, this connects people to things that are real in their lives. IAQ is not real in their life. UV light is not real in their life unless they're already a buyer and someone already made that connection. Pets, that's real. Asthma might be real. Dust, that's real. If you're in Georgia right now or you're in Florida or Louisiana, floods, that's real. If you're in Texas, that's real. Fires, if you're in California or Oregon or Washington State. Sickness, I think it's on the news every day. Mold, allergies, smoke, you get my drift. Start introducing the terminology, how important is air quality, and start giving them an opportunity to engage in more of a digital conversation. They can do that through different quizzes. Next, what is in the air you breathe? Particles. Now, on this particular page, you can introduce a different kind of feeling. Yuck. What do you think when you see particles flying around in your air, knowing that you breathe them? So putting them on a page, connecting to something that is... Yuck, Like, that's all I can think is I see I see this, right? The light shines in, it flashes through the window and you see this stuff you're breathing, yuck. So you're connecting immediately visually from adding particles to the page, but also again, reconnecting. Kim, if you can get the page ready that shows how these different dropdowns can show up in a search engine result, I'll have you share screens in just a second. So we want to connect with things that are real to them, things you do every day that can impact the air you breathe. Keep with that mission. Energy efficient homes do not positively impact the air you breathe. It actually makes it worse, not having fresh air, wildfire, smoke, renovation, hurricanes, natural disasters, floods, pollen, whatever your situation is in your particular area, include those things that are real life scenarios. Next, who cares about clean air? We've talked about the buyer identity or who are you selling to. Feel free to tell them who they are, right? If you have identified a target segment that you want to market to, remind them that you know who they are and you know what they like and you know why they like this, right? So we notice that health conscious families tend to be most educated, concerned, and proactive about the air we breathe. As a part of a bigger, more comprehensive view of their family's health and safety, they care about low oxygen levels, unhealthy particulates, blah, blah, blah. They are part of the air we breathe movement, are you? So connecting with that particular person, using graphics and images that are going to connect to them as well. Now, take the opportunity to introduce products. Remember, someone that's getting information or they're being introduced someone new is not somebody ready to buy, but you can test them here and there. Just don't test them plastered all over the page. So don't put your products all over the page. Right now we're trying to connect with the human's day-to-day life, their needs, problems they may have in their household, and then offer up that we might have solutions available. Getting into using references such as the CDC has a great asthma map. It talks about IAQ and where there are issues in air quality. Next is going to be connecting to the human soul that needs to have a deeper connection than a product or service. People want to feel good about what they do. They want to feel good about working with you. Give them a reason and remind them why it's important to work with you. Using language such as your local clean air and HVAC online store, it reminds them that you're a local business, you care about clean air, and we have an online store no different than Amazon, Home Depot, or any of the others. While every situation is a little different, our goal is to give our customers the products and services they're looking for in complete and transparency. Offer pricing online. Sometimes I'll hear people frustrated with the big box retailers or the Amazons or Home Depots, when in reality that sometimes we're driving them there because we're not giving consumers the same conveniences that they expect and get from a big box retailer or an Amazon. If consumers like the fact that they can jump on Amazon, find their filter online, put it in their cart, set it up on auto ship to show up on their porch every 3 months in the perfect little package box, it doesn't mean Amazon is wrong. It means we as small businesses are not offering consumers the same way to buy, the same conveniences. And if we don't, I guarantee you they're going to go somewhere else. But what do they really want? Consumers feel connected to their local community. They want to feel connected to doing something that feels good. And shopping with a local provider, supporting local businesses, supporting someone in their local community is something they want to do. You have to remind them that A, that's what they're doing when they're buying from you, and B, you offer them the same conveniences that a big box retailer does. Make them feel good about their purchases. I'm going to stop for a second on that. And Ryan, get your feedback on that piece. I know it's something we talked about in branding.
Yeah, for sure. I think there is this like, there's a book called Sales Differentiation that really kind of nails down a lot of this stuff of if you don't tell them how you're different, then they don't know. You take a step further and it's like, if you don't tell them why it matters, they're going to make the wrong assumption. So when you take like, hey, we're local, you need to explain why that matters. Because to some people, being small and local is a negative, and some people it's positive, and to some people being big is a negative, and some, and it really is like, hey, we're local, here's the reason why this matters, right? We care about you, or you can always get us, or we're your neighbor. We understand the climate. We understand the unique situations. We, you know, whatever the case may be, just always, you never want to take for granted that people think the way you think. You want to say, we're this, therefore it means blah to you as a person. And because there are things about being big that are positives, and if you're not big, you need to amplify your positive, not leave it up to them to decide, right?
Absolutely. And it's easy when you offer the same simple conveniences. By saying I have an online store, you can order online, you can pay online, you can set it up for auto ship. All of a sudden, it levels the playing field. You guys have the ability to do that. Next, drive into high efficiency homes don't help you. So we're connecting with the space that they're in right now. Most likely they're sitting in their house and something in here is going to connect with them, whether they're in their kitchen or their office or their bedroom or bathroom. Then reintroducing again the ability to connect to those products. And if that doesn't work, kind of the final shot at the end is, how important is it utilizing inline chatbots or something that is real time and specific to the topic gives you another opportunity. Ask a question. Most people have to click, right? If you say on a scale of 1 to 10, how is what? They got to click. They just need more. Sometimes it's just to see what happens next. But we've talked a lot about how chatbots help you gather information, drive more business, close lead convert leads 24/7. But here's what the global chatbot doesn't do. It doesn't specifically talk about someone who's on the site and has a concern with viruses or particulates or air quality and so forth. But you can have more than one chatbot on your site. You can have the global chatbot that works on any page 24/7. You can also put inbound bots that can help you gather quantitative information to have a better conversation. So we have a lot of clients that use these inbound bots. So this one specifically was saying, are you interested in having filters delivered to your house on a monthly, quarterly, or annual basis? Yes or no? Yes. Are you interested in having this? Ask a lot of, are you having problems with this? So it'll ask all these questions that are specifically related to this page. That's where you start to get details and information. When your CSRs pick up the phone, you're having a real conversation about a real problem with real issues, such as people in your family are suffering from allergies, asthma, breathing difficulties. They've got a lot of problems going on. So that conversation sounds a lot different when you call Mary back and say, hey, I noticed you guys are having issues with blank, instead of thank you for calling ABC Heating and Air Conditioning. How can I help you? Right? It's a much better conversation. And then as we dive in, again, these are different ways you can get information to show inside search results to stand off the page. Cam, you ready? I'm going to stop sharing.
All right. So this is for a client that we have out in Minneapolis. Can y'all see my screen okay?
Yep.
All right. So this is just simply AC Repair Minneapolis, Minnesota. I currently have my SERP set to 100 search results. So we're probably bottom of page 4 right now. When we first started out about 2 months ago, they were not ranking in the first 10 pages of Google for AC Repair Minneapolis. I believe they're located a little ways out of Duluth, so kind of a smaller town. What we want to start doing more often for all of our customers is making it to where we can have this FAQ style section showing up on SERP. Because what it does is it just takes up a lot of real estate on here. And as you can imagine, once this gets up to the top, just picture if you were up here at the top and you've got your Google business listings, and then all you're going to have if they're page 1, position 1 is just H2C in this section. So it's really cool. We're working to get that for all of our clients, and we'll be asking for FAQs soon.
So that's where content, thank you, Kim, I appreciate it. That's where content comes in. That's where improving the individual pages comes in. That's technically where the results plan comes in. It's the difference between transferring content you already own, writing content for services that you want to sell but you don't have content for, and then taking a page that already exists and improving it to either increase the rank and placement on search engines, or for a page that's already ranking on search engines to take up more real estate, as Kim mentioned, on search engines, or ideally it's to increase the number of conversions to make a single page connect better with a consumer and get more. So get more conversions. So out of the gate, when you first get started, everything you're focused on is, I got to get a website to launch. I got to get a website to launch. How long is it going to take to get my website to launch? Everything is literally based on, I'm going to refresh again. Oh, you need to see my screen, huh? Thanks, y'all. It's not Friday yet. So, as we move forward, I'm just going to skip by this. Design, development, content. In the beginning, this kind of process, when all we want is a website to go live, it's counterproductive and it's necessary, all in the same breath. Literally, it's an oxymoron. On one hand, I need a website live. I need it live right now. So you're rushing and rushing and rushing and rushing. You want it live? Speed is what matters. I get that. On the flip side, quality is not at the top of the list when it first comes out, because speed is the speed is the goal. I want it now. I want it now. So I'm not going to take time to figure out who my ideal client is. I'm not going to take time to figure out how to segment my customers or to fine tune all of the content, right? It's throw it over the fence. I don't want to participate. Get it live. Woohoo! Website goes live. Big launch, big party, and then blah, what the heck next? Right? All of these kind of counterintuitive oxymoron kind of strategies, they're fine. They're real. But we also need to really deal with what's next, right? Launching a website, making speed your goal, fine. That's fine. Make it the goal. Get it live. You've got somewhere to send customers to where they can get your contact information. They can access some level of content that you may have brought to the table or purchased. And then what? Next, you would think that we would move into marketing. We can't. Because at this point, there are a whole bunch of self-destructive things that we have to fix. We have to fix the fact that you may have information sitting out there that's inaccurate. Wrong phone numbers, wrong addresses, wrong company names, inaccuracies all over Google. And all over these local maps and directory listings and citation sites, that's self-destructive. We've got to figure out what your current online reputation is. If this isn't good, no reviews, bad reviews, poor reviews, old reviews, then we have another self-destructive mode. Website doesn't matter if these self-destructive things are in place. Next, we got to figure out what's going on in your social environment. No content. Last time you posted content was 2015. Everyone thinks you're closed. Now you're not relevant. Again, self-destructive. We've got to get that under wraps. Still, we haven't marketed anything. We just have this thing called a website that's out there that was done quickly. Next, we've got to figure out who your competitors are. What are they coming to the table with? Because this isn't just about what you're bringing to the table. This is also about who you're trying to knock over. Remember, there's only one page, one position, one for each search term you're trying to go after. You don't get five page, one positions, ones. That means you've got to climb the ladder and you have to knock a bunch of other websites out of the way in order to be able to occupy the next spot. That means whatever that company comes to the table with, how long they've been online, how well their website was designed, how many pages are on their site, how much content they have, how quality the content, what their domain authority is, how many backlinks they have, how many reviews they have, how much social media trust factors do they have, right? How many videos do they have? All of these things are mathematical equations you got to come to the table and be ready to compete. So sometimes it's not just about yourself. Well, it's never just about yourself, right? There are you, your ideal customer, your competition, and a robot, this thing called Google, and everything else in the middle. There's a lot going on, man. It's not easy. So at this point, hopefully the one thing that comes out of this is ugh, and I'm going to approach this with a smile and a collaborative attitude, because that's what it's going to take. Ryan, I see you. See, you've got some thoughts here.
Oh yeah, for sure. I think there's this podcast I was listening to the other day, and I think we as humans want this simple answer to a question. And the finality of it was like, embrace the complexity. Like, this stuff is hard. If it was easy, everybody would do it. And if everybody did the easy way, then it would dilute out. And so it is hard. Really, it really is about finding people you trust. That's why you work with somebody like you guys or somebody like us on hiring, so that you don't have to recreate the wheel. But finding this balance of much more, what's the most logical next step that will make an impact? Let's do that. But it will never end. Like, you're always going to be evolving your marketing. You're always going to be evolving your hiring. And so being able to balance speed with quality, being able to balance like speed with doing it the right way is a, like just a constant beach ball you have to stand on. But it just never ends, because if you end, like, then that implies that the whole world stands still.
Right.
And the world never stands still. Everything is constantly in motion. And so it really is like, it sucks. Everybody wants the answer that I check this box and I'm done. Right. But that it's just not that easy.
The fun ones are, I built a website. Why am I not on page one of Google? I don't know. Cause there's 22 million other people trying to also get to the same position, one spot. You're going to have to work hard at it, right? A website's not going to cut it. And it's interesting to hear that conversation. No different than if you're trying to hire the best employee, they are looking online right now and you're not the only option.
Oh, literally what you're saying right now is the same conversation we've had with clients this week. Hey, I put my job on Indeed. Why isn't it there? Why can't I find it? What do you mean Indeed removed it? Like, well, they didn't like what you put there. What, like, why am I not getting applicants? Well, Indeed's just Google. This is just the same thing. Like, you made this change. Cool. Everybody else made the change too. Or everybody else did something different. Like, embrace the complexity here. It's not easy. The flip side is, if it's done right, it can be crazy valuable for your organization, and you're creating assets that aren't easy to replicate. The difference between, say, paid marketing and true like search optimization and content optimization, those kind of things, is one is easy. You can just throw some money at it, but so can everybody else. But doing it the right way and figuring out how to find that balance means you actually create an asset, and doing things that other people aren't willing to do means you reap the rewards that other people don't get. But it really is like embracing the complexity. This is hard stuff. So you either got to learn or find somebody you trust or a mix of the two and dedicate yourself that, you know, lead generation is what drives my business forward, period. Like, you can't generate leads. It's like revenue solves all problems. Well, revenue is solved by leads. It just is. And so it's surprising how many people want to solve revenue problems by focusing on something different than marketing. But marketing surprisingly makes everything else easier.
Right. The number of digital moments that a consumer has and the number of competitors that they see before you ever get a chance to pitch, before you ever get to the table, it's infinite. Depending on where you're located, it can be 10 million, 12 million, can be 100 million, can be 100,000, literally the number of options that are out there. So first, infrastructure. All we've done so far with everything that I've already told you is we built a website and launched it with limited content, whatever you happen to purchase out of the gate or bring to the table. That's where we are right now. We got rid of all the self-destructive things that cause you to lose business, or lose ownership of your assets, or just lose, period. All the things that hurt your business. Jamal, in the scenarios that you work with, how frequently or what percent of time do you think during the active web project stage, what percent of time do you think is spent fixing the self-destructive things such as access, not having ownership, logins, and so forth, compared to proactive things to help them get leads in the door?
So the things that are holding you hostage, that takes a lot of time. It really takes away from all of the good things that we can be doing, the proactive things that we could be putting our minds on. It definitely takes you off of that. I would say the percentage is probably over 50% trying to gather those information or that information and meeting with the other marketing company along with the dealer that we're working with or anyone. It takes about probably 60% of the time if we're doing that. When we'd rather focus on the proactive things, like see where your local listings are, check out the current SEO value of your website and check all your links inside of your website and things of that nature.
Yeah, this is, thank you very much. This is something that I think people need to be more aware of coming into the process and the project is everyone's intent, including yours, is to spend time, energy, resources, and dollars towards things that are going to help you grow. And the reality is it depends on how healthy you're coming to the table. If you're coming to the table with your stuff together, you got owned assets, you have a brand, you have branding guidelines, you have a market segmentation, you've got amazing content. If you came to the table with all the infrastructure things in place, and we just got to sit down and have a conversation about marketing your business, identifying your next target, and owning and occupying and destroying the competition, oh, what a day that would be. But that is not reality. So that being said, the results plan. Yeah, you like that, huh, Jasmine? So, the results plan. You guys, this is what this kind of marketing strategy looks like. We're guilty of it, right? We come to the table and we're like, oh, we got an amazing system, a process. It's called the 12-step roadmap. There's only 12 steps, 12 stages, 122 things you need to get done. By the way, all of those things are changing all the time. They're evolving. Some of them are retiring. Some of them are being new. Something that we said a year ago doesn't actually apply today. Something that we did now could get you a penalty a year from now. We don't know what the next rules are because they won't tell us, or we could fake the funk and figure out how to manipulate the system to win without earning it. My gosh. That's real, right? So instead of just getting a headache, and I believe everyone just left the webinar and went to go get a cocktail after that moment, I get it. We all do, trust me, by 5:30. That's the feeling of the moment. Instead of being overwhelmed that it is so complicated, is so complex, oh my God, there's too much to do, you can't get stuck. You already decided to become an entrepreneur. You already decided to take a business to market. You already decided to hire some staff. You already bought some trucks. You already have bills. You already have your money dumped into this thing called a business. Now's not the time to freak out. Like, I don't know a better way to put it. Now is not the time to freak out. There's too much invested. So slow it down. For a minute, pick one thing, just one. What product or service do you want to sell? Pick one thing, not everything. Pick one. Pick one location that you want to make some money in. Let's take that one item, just one. One product you want to sell, one phrase you want to get found for, one service you want to sell. Let's perfect it. Let's get it visible to consumers. Let's get your phone ringing. You guys learn how to close that business so you've got a killer closing ratio. Make some money and then add another one. Just one. Turn something into cash. You got to figure out who's going to buy it. We're not marketing to drones, which means every individual service and product on our page, every individual page on a website, we got to figure out how to make it connect to a human being. We have to understand, how does the consumer who's going to buy this product or service, how do they think? How do they search? How do they feel when they land on this page? All of us, including ourselves, have pages that I know would make any consumer crazy scared to do business with you, right? It's the empty page, one picture. It says, we provide this product or service. I didn't have time for content. Deuces, I'm out. Mm-mm. We literally have to dive in and figure out who the customer is for that product or service. How do they think? How do they feel? Most importantly, what's going to make them buy? What's going to make them take action? Who is this human being? Who's coming to your website? What is she searching for? What's her issue? What's the problem? What does he find when he goes online and does a search? How does she feel when she shows him what he found? What does he do after he's found it? The reason I'm using he and she is because that's real. These are real human beings who care about real things that are coming to your site, and they're landing on a page and they have a feeling that overwhelms them and either makes them bounce, makes them read more, or makes them connect with you. right now more than ever, the number of people going to the internet to make these decisions is doing nothing but going up. Those search requests, when you remove everyday activities where referral takes place, the option is the internet. That's where this is taking place. As a company, at some point, pause for a minute and try and figure out who you are. Try and figure out the makeup, the DNA of your business. What are you about? What is your promise? How are you different? How are you going to stand out? And remember that most of your belief windows, the things that you believe are true, are not necessarily true. They're just a figure of your imagination because of past experiences. And these blind spots, these perspectives, these prejudices, these distinctions will prevent you from moving forward, will prevent you from making progress. If you built your website yourself and you're attached to it because it took a long time and it was a hefty project, it doesn't mean it's great. If your friend built it and you have ownership or you have loyalty, it doesn't mean it's the right decision. Watch the things you tell yourself because they don't necessarily mean that they're true. If you don't focus on a results plan, all the efforts you put in can go to naught. It can literally self-destruct. You can build a website. You can get on page one of Google. But if you don't jump in and take your time, slow it down a little bit, realize there's a human being on the other end that's got to make some decisions when they land on that page. If you don't pause, collaborate, jump on a call with Jamal, jump on a call with Kim, jump on a call with Jasmine, and literally dive into that and start having conversations that are tough. Who's coming to this page? How do they feel when they get here? How do you want them to feel when they get here? How can you differentiate yourself from everyone else who's selling the same thing? Choose that service. Figure out how you're going to get those calls, those emails, those texts. I'm going to skip that. Understanding the behavioral segmentation. People do things at different times. Right now, you have an entire United States that is currently in the process of moving out of cities into rural areas. Real estate markets are booming in rural areas, booming. Right now, this is a time when we need to take advantage of that. That gives us the ability to say, what kind of shoppers are the people who are buying new homes? So if an inspector says you need to get an inspection on an air conditioning system or a hot water heater or your furnace, are you there for that time and occasion? Do you have something that's designed for that? Do you have something designed for crazy heat? Do you have something designed for all of the hurricanes and the storms that are about to take place? If you're sitting, Jamal, your territory is going to get pummeled, and I'm sorry, by hurricanes, craziness, right? It's going to start happening. It's already happening. So what do they have that communicates to that segment? That's a real segment. If I'm in Louisiana or Texas or Alabama or Florida, those are real humans with real problems that happens every single year at the same time. We just started that season. That's a time, occasion, and occurrence that's going to cause issues that you need to have something that connects with. When do they make their purchases? That's different. When stuff breaks versus when they do research. When do they use it, right? Your seasonality. Another behavioral segmentation is the benefits. Divide your market into groups according to the different benefits that consumers seek, right? Why are they buying? Are they buying because of convenience? I'm a convenience shopper. I'm the epitome of a convenience shopper. Ryan is a convenience shopper. I know that. Okay. 100%, right? If I had to grow up to stop replacing my car because a tire popped, right? If I had a tire, I'm like, trade it in. Done. No flat tires. Like, I'm out. I can't handle that. No. So I will teach you how to take my money if you come into my house because I don't want to deal with it. I cannot deal with that box on the top of the roof. I don't even know where it is. I think it's over there. Like, just take my money and make sure the thing works. And if it doesn't, fix it and take my money again. And then make sure whatever has to happen to it in the middle, like take my money and do those things. And just let me know it's done. Like, that's who I am. Ryan, I know you're like that. Yes? Any thoughts?
Yeah, but I think that's true. And I think really your best saying right there is, the consumer will teach you how they want to buy if you'll listen and ask. Like, those segments will teach you that, whether you have to watch them online, whether you just want to ask them, But yeah, for sure. Like I don't enjoy buying most things. I don't enjoy the process of doing it. I enjoy the process of having it done. But I'll teach you if you'd ask me. And then if I believe that you would then adjust, that you'd listen.
Absolutely. You guys, that's a different kind of human. Okay, Chris, is there any way I can convince you that, are you at home? Can you take your phone or your video camera out and show them how you're a different kind of consumer? Because I believe you and Scott would fall into the same bucket. Scott, how likely are you to try and fix something on your own?
Oh, all day long, every day.
Oh, yeah. You want me to walk out to my AC?
Yes, I do. Oh, because yeah. I want them to see the difference in these two shoppers, right? The difference in what Ryan and I just said versus Chris and Scott.
My wife finds a level of pride knowing that I at least attempted to fix myself. And I can't even really get her to believe that that mowing my own lawn is not in my best interest. We grew up in a, you know, farm town, middle of nowhere, Omak, Washington, if you ever heard of it. And see if I can't turn this virtual background on. All right. So this is a poor attempt to replace a fan motor and as well as the capacitors. And if it's wrong, you guys are probably right. So I'm actually going to end up calling somebody today, or at least seeing if somebody will offer a virtual service where I can pay like $30 and get them on FaceTime.
Chris, call me.
Yes, ma'am.
So
I will not try to fix.
I fixed my pool pump, my Polaris. I mean, for the most part, I do a decent job, and I'm really not sure why the fan motor didn't work. So that's a first for me. Also did YouTube.
Jasmine is currently crying, by the way, if you can't see her because she's muted.
I know why it didn't work. And Chris, I told him to call us because we will walk him through, but I can tell you why it didn't work.
You know, I had a lot of confidence. I don't know where it came from. It obviously was very misplaced. Yeah, trying it.
So when I say divide the market into groups according to the different benefits the consumer seeks, I mean this to the nth degree. And my eyes are watering. Like, I don't know. I can't process how I could get on a call with Chris and he could hold up a capacitor and tell me about it. What? Like, he's a coder. He's a developer. My goodness. Okay. So... You're really muted on the bottom of your speaker. There you go.
Oh, there we go. Yeah, it comes from literally looking at systems from computer systems since their inception, reverse engineering them, figuring out how they work. I'm a tinker. And there's a certain piece of the population that falls into that homogenized profile of being somebody who likes to tinker and fix stuff on their own. But eventually, sometimes we hit a wall.
Or not fix it and need to get on a virtual service with someone. So you guys, those people are different. They can't all land on the same web page. So the website you launched does not fit the personality profile of Ryan. It doesn't fit the personality profile of Scott, and it doesn't fit the personality profile of Chris and myself and Jazz and right. It doesn't, and then you have Kathy, who if Kathy goes to your website and you're not specifically supporting a charity or participating in community events, or she doesn't see a soccer team supported, like if you have no community connection, Kathy's out, right? She's lovers of all people.
Oh, I'm going to tell you that shoppers are going to buy because of who you are and what your company culture is and what you support out there in your community, because I'm that buyer. I am one of those buyers. So you need to include those people as well.
I would say it's like a Venn diagram. If you've ever seen a Venn diagram, because as a soldier and an entrepreneur for a good part of my life, I would say that without a doubt, if I need help, I'm going to use a local business, period.
Yeah, 100%. I'm 100% on that. 100%. I want to use an entrepreneur that's in the local area. I also will forego that if they make it difficult. it's real. Like I'm out. I'll check out.
There's a certain amount of patience. And yes. We've been programmed to have less and less patience, unfortunately.
So here's your logic, right? When you look at these people, is it for convenience? So conveniences, I love my Nest thermostat, but I don't know how to work it. So I pay virtual service people to help me program the stupid thing. I like to make sure that my alarm system, my garage doors, my front door, it locks and unlocks on demand from my phone. I can turn up my heat, turn it down, turn on air conditioning, turn it off. I can operate everything from my phone. That's for convenience. Is it necessity? Something's broke. Is it for ease of use? Is it health? Is it safety? Is it savings? Are they discount shoppers, promotion shoppers? As I was just mentioning with Kathy, does it make them feel good? These are all different markets. Next, user stats. Divide your market into groups according to how consumers purchase. Are they loyal? I know I'm loyal as long as it's easy. As long as you take, like right now, I'm going to cancel my insurance because they can't seem to take money from me on a regular basis just off my card. They want me to actually go to the website and pay online. I will never do that. That's making me crazy. I cannot have that. I'm asking them every single month, can you please just take the money? Can you please just take the money? No, ma'am, we don't have that available. We need you to go online. Like, I'm out. I was loyal, but I'm not now. Are they high tech? Are they low tech? Do they want the personal service? Are they non-experts? Most HVAC companies are launching websites that are geared towards someone that has a really good understanding of HVAC. Most. So we've got to work in, how do you communicate with people that are not experts? Is it a referral? If I am a referral referred to a company, I come with an inherent value and likelihood of doing business with you. That's a little bit better than someone that finds you off the internet. Still going to do my research. Still, those destructive measures may push me out or push a referral partner out. If you don't have reviews, if your social media site's bad, if your website looks scary or like your child built it, all of those things, you'll take a referral and you'll lose the business before you ever know you had a referral. You won't find out for years until someone says, oh, I referred my mother. Well, she never called because you scared her. Next, user stats. Next is usage rate. Looking at all of your customers and figuring out kind of where you want these buckets. Are they a subscriber? How many of your clients are subscribed? Meaning, are they on auto ship? Do they have their filters auto shipped? Do they have their UV lights auto shipped? Are they subscribed to your maintenance plan? Do you have a credit card on file with recurring subscriptions coming in like clockwork and you just go service their home like for convenience? Are they first timers? How do they feel when they get there? Are they one-timers, some-timers, influencers? You guys have people come to the site, for example, real estate agents. Real estate agents are influencers, heavy influencers. And if you don't have a home for a real estate agent to help their customers who need home inspections to get those clear to close, remember what's important to the realtor. Technically, they want the condition clear so that they can close a business and get their check. That's technically what's important. So if I go to your website and there's nothing on there that says you do inspections, the consumer's out. So just remember, there's no brand without segmentation. There's no segmentation without brand. There's no customers if you're not visible, if they can't find you. There's no conversions if you don't make it easy, on their terms easy, not your own belief terms. There's no action when it doesn't feel right. It just made me laugh, actually. I should be laughing at that. I'm going to move on. So here's the nuts and bolts before we jump out of here. Number one is differentiation. The reason for being. Why are you there? How are you different? What's your unique selling proposition? What is the brand or the soul behind? What is your promise? Number two, making sure that it's relevant. How does it fit in people's lives? The combination between differentiation, how different you are from everyone else, and the relevance, why people need it, that technically tells you what your possible marketplace looks like, how big your market is. Now, okay, I'm going to leave that one alone as well. I'm not going to keep reading. Next, esteem. Esteem is the degree of respect. Now, I'm seeing the ways of this PowerPoint presentation, and I see you laughing. I'm having a hard time with this one. Okay, esteem is essentially the way people feel about you guys. If someone loves you because you keep your promises, because you're trying, because you've earned that reputation and respect, because you care, because you meet them where they are, right? All of a sudden, forgiveness comes with that, right? Forgiveness is a big deal because stuff happens. Stuff breaks, stuff's late, stuff happens in our lives, right? You heard that too. That's real. You need forgiveness. Without esteem, we're in trouble. And then finally, knowledge. This is the extent of the consumer's awareness that you exist, right? If you don't exist, if there's no knowledge that you're an option for the services that they need or the solutions they need, nothing else matters. This is what Ryan was talking about earlier. Your intention on marketing your business, that is the process of making your business visible to those people who need it, should probably be a high priority. And the combination between differentiating your business from everyone else, making sure it's relative to what they need, defining or creating a feeling and esteem of brand promise and of trust and of caring and concern, and making sure that you're visible, game over. You have a business. We're rocking and rolling. We're moving. We're growing. Any thoughts on that before I move on? Are you sure you don't want to read every line item on there? Jasmine, you want to go through relevance? Okay, so. I don't know what happened with that. Scott, I'm not picking you for specific reasons.
Somebody was up late last night working on PowerPoint slides and wasn't thinking, were they?
But it typed well. So.
Have a good at the mint moment.
So, number one, service. Number two, product. Number three, promise. Number four, process. Next. You got to choose the page that represents that. You got to choose the phrase that represents that. And you got to choose a target location. You're going to have to get specific. Last time I checked, money wasn't growing on trees still, which means we got to tighten our grip. We got to get a little bit more focused on what we're going to concentrate on. We have to ensure that we're visible, attractive, and easy. This is not getting any better. Visible to those people looking for you. You got to get look good when they get there, and you got to make it easy to do business with you. I am getting a lot of head shaking right now. This comes from four elements: one, website; two, content; three, marketing; and your brand. All right, with that, I am going to end on that note. Ryan, you talked about time management and right now, still, if you're sitting in a situation where you feel overwhelmed, now is the time to figure out how to get unstuck. You got to take on some of these daunting processes. And I know you're moving into summer, and I know it feels overwhelming. Ryan, any thoughts on how to get unstuck?
Yeah, I mean, that's really, so you allocate a certain amount of time. And everybody's like, I don't have time. Trust me, you have some time, half an hour to an hour, something like that each day. I like doing it. I'm like, I'm going to wake up early. I'm not going to turn on my devices. And I'm going to answer this one question, like, what's the one thing I could do right now that will make everything else easier or unnecessary to completion? Not like just do partway. And completion could mean I got it to the point where I can give it to an employee, or I got it to the point where it's live. But what's that one thing? And usually you can find like a 30 to 90 minute project that you're like, you know what, if I just record this one video to teach my employee this one thing, they'll quit asking me this question every day and it will free up the next bucket of time. We tend to create giant checklists and giant to-do lists and huge projects and initiatives, which gives us all the reasons why we can't act. But the most important thing, there's a podcast on it, is make up your mind right now. I'm going to do X. Just flood yourself with confidence that it's the right thing to do and take massive action on it. So you say, today I want to take and fix my Google local search. That's what I'm doing right now. And after that, I'll go to work on whatever else. But if I got that one thing done today, it would replicate over time. which is just the opposite of make a big giant to-do list, which is overwhelming, and make it a big project, which is overwhelming. Like, just the one thing, just pick one. And you're, it's the 1% replicated per day makes massive improvement. That is, like, it's for me, I'm the same. I guarantee, Jennifer, you're the same. Every day I wake up with an overwhelming amount of stuff to do. And the one thing I've found is if I can do one thing, number one, it actually fixes it. Number two, it makes me feel a little bit lighter. Like, the next thing is better. If I can accomplish something by breakfast, man, like, the rest of my day is good. But if I hit lunch and I haven't made progress because I got just down in the muck, like, it just gets worse, not better. And so that's, for me, I pick my one thing each day that I'm like, man, if I could just finish this really quick, I'll feel good. And that just slowly, methodically digs you out of the hole. It never goes away. So don't try to convince yourself that it's, and then I'll get to stop doing it. It's more like, that's the habit. Each day I'm going to accomplish my one thing.
100%. That is my every day. Every morning, everyone says, how do I get so much stuff done? Not a day goes by that I don't have something that's going to give me back my minutes done before 9 a.m. Not a single day. Every single day. This morning, we have 101 questions that come in about search engine optimization. What's included in search engine optimization? I can either be busy being busy answering the same question every single day, or I can say no more. That's my item. I planned it for this morning, and we sat down and we built a chart that shows every single thing that happens every single day. It's on the website. You can go to marketing services, scroll down, click on SEO. That page, that was done this morning because we've answered that question so many times, and I have two choices. I can be busy being busy and continue like Groundhog's Day to wake up and have the same repeat day continuously and not make time for the things that give me my minutes back. Or I can pause, sit in my bed with my laptop and create the page that answers all the questions that I get every single day that take away my time. It's an oxymoron not to pause and to focus on building one thing that prevents you from having to do that. And right now, just looking at the people that are on this call, we got owners on the call. Charles from AccuTemp, you are golden. Maylee, you're golden. You're taking time right now to do the same thing. You guys blocked off this time, and I bet you I haven't looked. I'm 37 minutes over the allotted time. So first off, I apologize because I took more than you needed or more than I had planned. But second, you can make time. I mean, literally take one thing in your business that is a duplicate process, an inefficiency, something that you have to say every day. Talk to your CSRs, talk to your technicians, talk to your team. That's what I do every week. Hey, you guys, what's driving you nuts? Hey, you guys, what's a question you get asked? Sometimes I think the term frequently asked questions is just total trash. Everyone treats it without the emphasis that actually means anything. Frequently asked questions means something. A single frequently asked question should turn into a blog post with the chart, with a checklist, with a video. Everything can go in a digital format that the next time that frequently asked question gets asked, you send them a link. Every time. And if you take what your best salespeople, take your best salesperson who's seen it all, they know everything. They've seen everything, what not to do. Your best technician, they know all the garbage that takes place. They know the top 10 questions to ask. They know the top 10 things to avoid. They've seen every kind of crazy scenario there is. Why keep them a secret? Take what's in their head, pause for just a minute, digitize it. So all of the people who need to hear that message, all of the people who need to understand that or have those same questions can find it while you do something else. Don't say, I don't have time to create content. If you have time to say the same thing over and over again, answer the same question over and over again, do the same presentation over and over again, you have time for content. We have to stop the bleeding. So, any thoughts before we get out of here?
Great.
All right, you guys, with that, if you need help, please, please don't hesitate to reach out. It's easy to connect with us. You can send us a text. You can go to our website. Ryan Kohler from Higher Dimensions and Applicant List. That is our partner for everything that has to do with jobs. Here's how this works. As everything starts to funnel and make sense, you have to have a touch point in your business at every single stage. When marketing works, you need people. Period. Those things are connected. The process for acquiring amazing humans are the same, whether it's for jobs, is the exact same thing as customers. It's identical. It's creating content, optimizing the content, placing it where those people who are looking are searching, being an option for the jobs that they're looking for, where they're looking for it, and having a message, a brand of something that is strong enough that's gonna connect with the best of the best of the best. It's all connected. So please don't hesitate to reach out if you need connection. Ryan, what's the best way they can reach you outside of going through us and we'll forward them? Unmute. 1, 2. Okay, yeah.
You go to higherdimensions.com, right? Funnels everything to us. Our phone number's there. You can reach us right there. So higherdimensions.com, super, super easy.
All right, with that, you guys, we love you very much. Thank you for taking time with us today, and we will see you next week. Thanks, everyone.